para mí un placer presentar a un invitado de este instituto que, pues, antes del temblor ya habíamos planeado que viniese y que ahora más que nada surge el interés de colaborar con nuestro país, con las consecuencias de este temblor que tuvimos. Me refiero en esta ocasión al doctor Mario Estefano, un amigo personal
de hace muchos años, que hemos tenido un tema común de interés, que es el de las estructuras irregulares, y tema en el que hemos trabajado por mucho tiempo. El doctor Mario Estefano obtuvo su laurea, su licenciatura en ingeniería de la Universidad Federico II de Nápoles, que es una de las universidades definitivamente la más importante en el área de ingeniería sísmica en Italia, y que tiene la característica de ser probablemente una de las universidades más viejas del mundo. Él hizo su maestría en ingeniería estructural en la Universidad de California en Berkeley, y su doctorado en la Universidad Federico II en Nápoles. Desde que terminó su carrera, se incorporó a la Universidad de Florencia, llevando su trabajo a la Facultad de Arquitectura de esa universidad, que en la concepción italiana o europea de las escuelas de arquitectura es donde ocurre mucho del trabajo en ingeniería estructural. Y desde entonces ha liderado un grupo dentro de esta universidad muy orientado a la experimentación y el análisis de estructuras complejas. Sus contribuciones importantes en este tema han sido, por supuesto, en las estructuras irregulares, algo que se le reconoce al verle nombrado el coordinador del comité europeo, denominado TG8, y ahora con otro nombre que se llama WG8, que es un grupo de trabajo dedicado al estudio de las estructuras irregulares y complejas dentro de de Europa. Pues que tomó este cargo, ha organizado una serie de eventos de los cuales hemos participado, algunos de los que aquí estamos, acá, eventos bianuales en los que se presentan los avances que se tienen en este tiempo. El doctor De Stefano es autor de numerosos artículos en el área de ingeniería civil, en el área de ingeniería estructural y particularmente en la ingeniería sísmica. Por lo presente, bienvenido a México y estamos listos para escuchar tu conferencia, que va a ser comportamiento sísmico y diseño de edificios irregulares. Welcome.
Yes. So, Gustavo, thank you very much for introducing me, and I also thank you very much for inviting me to spend this week at UNAM. I'm enjoying it, this period, very much, and I think our cooperation will be intensifying in the coming years, as we have found many research areas beyond irregular buildings that we can cooperate. So I'm very pleased and honored to give a seminar in this Salon de Seminarios, which is named after a giant of earthquake engineering, Emilio Rosenbluth. When I was a student, the first book, international book on earthquake engineering that I read was the Milestone in Earthquake Engineering, so the Fundamentals of Earthquake Engineering that Rosenblut co-authored with Nathan Newmark. That book, it was edited in 1971, not only presented the main principle of earthquake engineering, but I think that we can find the roots of the main research areas in earthquake engineering that have been developed in the subsequent 50 years. I'm also pleased to see among participants in these attendees in this workshop, in this seminar, Professor Luis Esteva, who participated in the workshop that we held in 2002 in Florence as acting president of the International Association of Earthquake Engineering. And thank you to all participants for attending this seminar. So, why we talk about irregular buildings? And because post-earthquake surveys show always that structural irregularity is one of the main causes of severe damage and collapse of buildings under strong earthquakes. This was the case also in 1985, the Mexico City earthquake, and there were statistics, I think, that were published by Professor Esteva with Professor Meri about damaged buildings. And this has also been the case in the recent 19 September Central Mexico earthquake. Just a few words about the outline of my seminar. Of course, this is a very wide topic. I will just touch some issues that I believe are important. So we'll start with types of irregularity, and we will see effects on the seismic behavior. We will talk also about some issues in some research issues in the field, and then we will go to see how European and Italian code, seismic code, address the problem of irregularity. And we'll find, at the end, we'll give just a few indications, very basic indications about interventions to mitigate irregularity conditions. So let's start about structural irregularity. Of course, there are causes for structural irregularity. And I would I just summarize these causes. First of all, economical causes. Of course, when you in very densely populated areas, you try to develop any piece of land, I would say. And so this is one main reason for starting with irregular shape of building and then at the end of the day with irregular structural irregularity. There are also functional reasons why buildings become irregular, and because distribution of function of the building, or also lightening of buildings may result in irregular shapes. And finally, we have aesthetical formal reasons, and this is also the architects are responsible for architectural design. So in many cases, this architectural design, the goal of the some aesthetical goal end up with irregular shapes. So for this reason, really, it is impossible to forbid design of irregular buildings because there are very basic reasons. It's impossible to forbid the design of irregular buildings, but both engineers and architects, in my opinion, must be aware of the effects of irregularity on seismic behavior. So, of course, when we talk about irregularity, we are talking about regularity. Conversely, irregularity is, let's say, I would say that irregularity, the concept of irregularity is a fuzzy one. We cannot define boundaries of irregularity. And of course, conversely, perfect irregularity is just an idealization. I can say that in real life irregularity conditions go far beyond the imagination of any any code writing body. Okay, so it's not easy to classify irregularity, but usually code, seismic code, refer to mass distribution, strength distribution, stiffness distribution in plane and in elevation. So they distinguish between plane irregularity and vertical irregularity. In real life, they are both combined. And very rarely a building can be defined as perfectly regular. So plane irregularities are due to uneven plane distribution of vertical resistant structure or masses and or masses. Vertical irregularity are due to discontinuity along the building height of the mass, stiffness, strength. When we talk about elastic behavior, we look at mass and stiffness, but since we know that our buildings undergo large inelasticity under strong earthquakes, we have to talk about also strength. Which is the outcome of irregularity? We will see some picture later. The outcome of irregularity is the overdemand, seismic overdemand on specific elements, which can lead to their early collapse, while not allowing the entire building to exploit its full capacity. So let's talk about plane irregularity. There are very simple scheme here. It's not. It's just to show the main concept. And basically, we have. We can start as a parameter for irregularity. We can plane irregularity. We can consider the stiffness eccentricity between the mass and the center of mass and center of stiffness. Of course, we in the elastic behavior of range, also the center of strength comes into the picture. So because of this eccentricity, building floors undergo not only translation, but also rotation. So we have the torsional behavior of the building. Of course, mitigate this effect, we need to balance our building plan. So vertical irregularity, the concept of vertical irregularity is mostly, there are also other examples of vertical irregularity, but as I said before, we just concentrate on the main issues. So vertical irregularity may be related to the presence of the so-called soft weak stories. And of course, there are reasons why we have weak stories. As I said before, we can have weak stories because we have commercial areas at the ground floor. So these, but also there are other reasons. Also, there is the effect of the infill panels, which comes to the picture. But at the end of the day, the presence of weak story lead to early collapse because most of the deformation is concentrated at the one floor, while the upper floors behave like a rigid box. And so this may lead to early collapse of the building. Of course, this soft story can be present also at the intermediate stories, not just at the ground floor. It's well known that soft story can arise also at the intermediate story. This is a typical example of soft story. We have that really the upper part of the building behaves like a rigid box, and everything is concentrated at the first floor, at the ground floor. Should we forbid? That's the question. Should we forbid soft story? Let's say this type of pilotis building. We cannot forbid this, but we should, of course, mitigate this effect with proper design specifications. We'll talk a little bit about this later. These are examples of very well-known examples of intermediate soft stories. And this picture comes from the Kobe earthquake in Japan. So, as I said before, we can look at both plane irregularity and vertical irregularity in as the let's say looking at their effects. Their effect is to not irregularity do not allow uniform distribution of damage, and therefore we cannot exploit the strength relativity reserves of the entire structure. You see here on the left you have a case of torsional behavior, and you have the flexible side of the building that is much more damaged than the stiff side. And the same you have here for a kind of vertical irregularity. You have the upper part of the building which is less damaged. Of course this building is collapsed, has collapsed, but collapse happened at the full ground floor, so everything concentrated at the first floor. So that's, in my opinion, the way to look at both vertical and plane irregularity. What code do? We will see later, but just to anticipate, building code, I'm referring to the Eurocode or the Italian code, which is basically is based on the Eurocode. They penalize design of buildings as classified as irregular by prescribing larger design force. We will see that this a first step, I would say, and much more, we need much more, I would say, developed, much more precise rules, and there is also research to be done in the field. Okay, so since this topic is very important in earthquake engineering, the European Association of Earthquake Engineering has established a working group on the in this field, seismic WG8, seismic behavior regular complex that I coordinate. Actually, this is a field that in a way as a bridges engineering and architecture. So my opinion, as I said before, also architects must be aware of defects because, let's say, irregularity starts from morphological irregularity and then it goes to structural irregularity. We have been promoting, so this working group promotes research in the field. Actually, we have also, every 3 years, we have a workshop. One workshop was in 2002 in Florence. The last workshop actually has been in Bucharest in last October. And the previous ones that were held in Haifa and in the and in Opole, in Haifa in Israel, and Opole in Poland, have resulted in the publication of two books that have been published by Springer, and this is just the indication of the books that I co-edited with Oren Lavan from the Technion and Zimbinia Zembati from the Opole University. So there are many research issues in the field. I'm just mentioning one, okay? So in the books that I was presenting, there are many research issues. But one, important research issue is the extension of pushover analysis to irregular buildings. And basically, most of research work has been devoted to plain irregular buildings, okay? So, The standard pushover analysis is a well-established analysis method for regular structures, for planar structures, I would say. So basically, the assumption is planar behavior. So we have one target displacement. I think that most of you are familiar with pushover analysis. One issue is the target when we stop with the pushover analysis. We stop at a certain target displacement. So for planar structure, we have one target displacement. And also, since we have a first mode, a dominant mode, we have a pattern of lateral force which is proportional to this first mode, dominant mode. What happens... So what happens in the case of irregular structures? To better understand what this, I think that we need to introduce some parameters. So for, of course, to define parameters is very easy for one-story buildings, okay? So these parameters can be extended with some difficulties to multi-story buildings. But of course, the response of a one-story building depends on the period, on the stiffness, eccentricity. And another parameter which is important is the stiffness radius of geation, which measures the centrifugation of distribution of stiffness, are dimensionalized with respect to the mass radius. So actually building can be classified in torsionally flexible and torsionally stiff depending on the value of this parameter, okay, which is torsional radius are dimensionalized with respect to the mass radius. If this parameter is greater than one, we have torsionally stiff buildings. If it's less than one, we have a torsionally flexible building. We need to remind this because I will refer to this parameter in the further slides. When we go into the inelastic range of behavior, we have further parameters that influence the response. Is the force reduction factor, of course, the strength eccentricity. We can define also strength eccentricity. Of course, this is easy for a one-story building. It's not very easy to define this parameter for multi-story building, and we can define also a strength radius of geration. So we can also define a torsionally strong, a torsionally weak building. So given these parameters, what is the problem when we apply Pushover analysis to plane irregular buildings? First of all, we don't have a one dominant mode, because we have at least one torsional mode that is influencing the response. So the loading pattern that we use in the pushover analysis becomes more complex. On the other side, we have also that if we compute the envelope of lateral displacements, because of torsional coupling, the envelope of lateral displacement presents amplifications. Let's say if we have torsionally stiff buildings, we have the red line, so we have amplification on the flexible side and reduction on the stiff side. If the building becomes torsionally flexible, we have amplification on both sides. Okay, we have amplification on both sides. So one target displacement that is maybe that can be the displacement at the center of mass is not enough, because we need to account for this amplification in plane in order to catch the effects of capture the effects of torsional behavior. So from these two observations, we have two different. Okay, just one. I have two. Okay. Okay, so from one point of view, so if we consider the response of irregular building, plane irregular is influenced not just one mode, translational mode, but also at least by a torsional mode, is one side. From the other side, we have an uneven plane distribution of a lateral displacement. So from these two point of views, we different methods have been developed, and you can find the literature to address this problem. One class of methods is the so-called methods that are based on multimode pushover procedures. So we try to capture the effects of torsional behavior by several independent pushover analysis that consider different loading patterns that are associated to different model shapes. So the problem here is how to combine the effects that you get from each mode that you want to represent. And of course, this combination cannot be an elastic one, because we are talking about inelastic behavior. I think, in my opinion, the so-called methods that are based on displacement amplification, so They recognize that a single displacement, target displacement, is no longer sufficient. So we, those methods try to capture the amplifications that are given by torsional coupling in the inelastic range of behavior. So these methods are the ones that I believe that are more promising because they look directly to the outcome of torsional coupling. The outcome of torsional coupling is this, is this uneven distribution of lateral displacement. So, just a little bit of history in this field. So, these methods that are based on displacement amplification started in, end of previous century and 2000. So what is important, this method, the extended two method that was proposed by FIFA, there are also methods that have been proposed by some Italian colleagues. That is this method, corrective eccentricity method. So I will focus on the extended N2 method. I will focus mainly on the extended N2 method and on the corrective eccentricity method. So how do they work? I can also skip this. Let's look first how the corrective eccentricity method works. So here you have the deformer. This is a case of in which we have a torsionally flexible building. This deformed lateral envelope, the envelope of lateral displacement in the inelastic range of behavior. So if you apply conventional pushover analysis, you will get just this straight line. Okay, and so you will be, which is really unconservative, both at the flexible side, at the flexible side, and at the stiff side. So how can you correct this? The idea is that to conduct pushover analysis with two eccentricities. In this way, the envelope of lateral displacement that you get covers the time history, the one that comes from time history analysis. Because, of course, with pushover analysis, we want to approximate time history analysis. So the problem is that how you calibrate these eccentricities, okay? And this is a problem because these eccentricities have been calibrated based on response of a single story building models. So they are function of the stiffness eccentricity, the stiffness radius. But these parameters are very easy to compute for one story building. The shortcoming of this method is that it's very difficult to extend definition of this parameter to multi-story buildings. So that's why I feel that the extended N2 method proposed by FIFA is very promising because how does it work? The red dotted curve is the nonlinear time history analysis. The blue line is the pushover analysis, the conventional pushover analysis. What do you do? You instead of considering you consider as envelope of lateral displacement this red line. So from one side, from on the flexible side, you consider the effect, the displacement amplification that you get from modal analysis. So you don't make an elastic analysis, you make a modal analysis to capture these amplifications. And on the stiff side, you apply the no reduction rule. So you consider the lateral displacement that cannot be smaller than the displacement at the center of mass. So from one side, you have the no reduction rule. The other side, you have amplifications that are computed by simple elastic analysis. So which is the assumption which is underlying to the extended N2 method is that with the elastic prediction of the displacement amplification is an upper bound of the inelastic ones. Okay, so the idea is that torsional effects decrease in the elastic range of behavior. So if you measure torsional effects in the elastic range of, behavior, you make a conservative estimate. Many studies have shown that displacement application really decreases as the structure experiences larger elasticity. So the modal response spectrum envelope is an upper bound and can be used. Sorry. For example, there are studies that show here, there are studies by Bento, Rita Bento. You can see here the red, in this case, the flexible sides on the left side of the building. The black line represents the envelope of time history analysis. And you can see that the red, the green line, you see, it's very simple in this case, represents the prediction that we make with extended and two meters. So the amplification is larger, so we are on the safe side. There is also another case in which still the red, black line represents the amplification that we obtain with the time history analysis, and with the N2 method we get bigger amplification, which is good for us because it means that we are on the safe side. Actually, I want to mention also a study that I was co-authoring with Dr. Pintucchi, in which we made a very wide parametric analysis, and we saw that the elastic prediction of amplifications made by modal analysis are conservative for torsionally flexible and moderately torsionally stiff framed building structure. So this assumption holds for framed structures, but this does not hold for very torsional stiff structures such as shear-walled buildings. In this case, the inelastic torsional response is bigger than the elastic one. So the prediction that we make with model analysis is unconservative. So as I said, there are many research issues, but of course I just was mentioning this one that I believe is important because today we believe that pushover analysis is the best analysis method for professional application when you want to make assessment of the building or even to design a building with pushover analysis. You consider inelastic behavior of the building, but without the complication of the dynamic nonlinear analysis, because dynamic nonlinear analysis is quite more complex to be carried out. Of course, we are in a research institute here. We are not afraid of carrying out dynamic nonlinear analysis, but in design offices, of course, the situation is quite different. So the pushover analysis is the method that we believe is more convenient. So that's why I focused on this aspect, research issues. Let's go now to the final part of my presentation and the seismic code specification for irregular buildings. In general, I would say that the code writing bodies have not yet translated in the codes the research developments that have been over the last decades. So in general, I believe that both European and American codes are in need of improvement regarding specification for irregular structures. I want just to mention this point, important point, because as I said before, the European code and the Italian code penalize irregular buildings by reducing the Q factor, okay? By reducing the Q factor, so in this way, these buildings are designed with larger design forces. But this is a first step, I would say, but it's a kind of primitive first step, because the point is that this overstrength is blindly distributed among all resisting elements, While we saw that from behavior that the problem is confined to some resisting elements. So the next step will be to assign this overstrength mainly to the resisting elements that are affected by the irregularity. And we saw that mainly are the flexible side of buildings in plain irregular buildings, or the elements that are the soft story. So over there, this overstrength must be concentrated. And I'm pleased that the new, as we discussed a little bit in the last few days, this issue with some with Gustavo and some young colleagues, I'm pleased to know that the new Mexican code is more careful. So the overstrength is given really mostly to the story that is a soft story. Okay, there is a rule why it's not distributed uniform, let's say, to all, but mainly to the soft story. So this is the same optimization, okay, of the distribution of the overstrength must be done also for plain irregular buildings, and this, I believe, is more complex, but this is the way to do it, because otherwise you are going to give overstrength also to elements that are not affected by the irregularity. So how this is one important point. But as I said before, the first step is to define a building as regular or irregular. Even in this area, I think that there is much that the seismic code indications can be really improved. Let's look at the criteria for plain irregularity. The first criterion, I don't read it, but you can read it easily, is very qualitative. Plan configuration will be compact. So the second criterion, the ratio between plan dimension of rectangle, so you want to avoid very elongated in plan, but it's a problem that is more related to the asynchronous ground motion, okay, more than irregularity itself. So the third criterion is also a kind of morphological criterion. It's not related to the parameters that govern the problem. And then the fourth criterion is related to the assumption of rigid floor diaphragm. But this assumption is a basic one. If you think a little bit, a building is a building because there is a rigid floor diaphragm. Otherwise, we cannot talk about is a three-dimensional structure, but is not a building. So it's not really related to the irregularity as we saw before. Of course, if you don't have a rigid floor diaphragm, your behavior is irregular, but it's regular in the sense that it becomes a three-dimensional structure. It's not anymore a building, I would say. Okay, so let's look at the criteria for vertical irregularity. Even in this case, the criteria are really qualitative in a way, except the third one. I don't want to spend time, but the other are qualitative. So I believe that there is a lot of research to be done in the field of giving more specific and criteria for regularity, and I believe that these criteria must be related to some mechanical parameter of the building. Okay, so in a way, for example, the American code, the American UCB code, Uniform code, Building Code, UBC code, relates to plain irregularity, computing the ratio of the maximum displacement to the average displacement. So that parameter is much more meaningful because it's measured on the building and is a quantitative measure. It's not a qualitative measure of irregularity. Another point that is important when we talk about design of irregular building is torsional stiffness strength. So it's very important to reduce effects of irregularity, especially when we talk about plain irregularity, to centrifugate stiffness and strength of the building. This is an area also that could be addressed better by codes. I want just to also to mention that our existing buildings, at least in Italy, that were designed for vertical loads only, basically they tend to be torsionally flexible buildings, because the perimeter columns carry, in principle, an axial load which is lower than the central columns. So you, when you design for vertical loads only, you have that your columns at the center of the plan, the building plan, are strong, stiffness is stronger, while the perimeter columns are very thin. So this is it's bad for seismic behavior, because they are torsionally flexible building plans. Okay, let me. Another issue that is important in design, I'm just underlining some important point, is the, unfortunately this is in Italian, but anyway, so is the simplification of building plan. You have very cumbersome building plans here. This simplification of this building plan by introducing seismic joints that, let's say, from structural point of view, you transform your complex plan in a set of building plans that are simple ones. Just a few words, just to finish my presentation, regarding the intervention that we can make on existing buildings to mitigate irregularity conditions. There are very, very basic examples. We can talk about traditional techniques and innovative techniques. I'm just showing here, of course, among traditional, okay, this is a case in which the building plan, you have this core that is displaced on the upper left side of the building plan, so you have torsional behavior, but of course you can mitigate this in a very simple manner by introducing shear walls on the other side. And so in this case, so this is, I would say, a very straightforward manner, and there are a lot of applications of this technique with shear walls to reduce plane irregularity. But of course there are, so in this case, so of course the goal of the intervention is to reduce the stiffness eccentricity, and then in this case you get translational behavior. But of course there are innovative techniques, among one, base isolation is one attractive technique, because in this case you are going, the goal is to have a distribution of base isolator which is symmetrical one, because this is going to condition to influence the overall behavior of the building. And so in this case you, the response of the beam will be really defined by the distribution of the base isolators, so there will be just small torsional effects on the upper part of your structure. So there are applications like in the Prada boutique in Tokyo, where the distribution of seismic isolator is symmetrical and makes regularize the building response also for the upper part of the building. So what are the conclusions of my presentation? I'm just summarizing the main concept. First of all, irregularity cannot be forbidden by seismic codes, and we have seen the reasons. It's important, and I stress this, that both engineers and architects must be aware of effects irregularity. We have seen the macroscopic irregularities, plane irregularities and vertical irregularities, the most common. But we have also some, I would say, situation of irregularity at the element level. Okay, when you, the interaction between the column and the infill panel, and if the infill panel is not a does not cover fully the column, but is a partial infill panel. So these are situation of irregularity that start from the architectural design, and then let's say they affect structural behavior. So both engineers and architects must be aware of effect irregularity. I think that there is a lot of research activity that must be done in the field. We have seen some examples, and I stress also the issue of regularity criteria. Regularity criteria must become quantitative and not qualitative as they are now, at least in European Italian code provisions, and that's one final conclusion that is related to our codes. I see that the Mexican code is a bit address some of the concerns that I have for our European codes, and I believe that even in this field we need to develop new design criteria and to improve the current seismic code. So thank you very much for your attention. Of course, I am happy if you have any question. I will be happy to answer.
Grazie, grazie Mario. Alguna pregunta del público, por favor? Preguntas? Well, to start the thing, I got a question.
Yes.
All right. And asymmetric buildings, when we go to the court, and then you have the methods that are recommended in those buildings, you assume that the structure is in an undamaged condition, whereby the eccentricity is a real parameter of that is used for design. Yeah. When you go to the basics of the codes for limit states that go beyond the serviceability limit state, then eccentricity stops being a parameter.
Yeah.
Why? Because many of the reasons why you have an eccentricity is because you have walls, and the walls may be infill walls, or they are walls that, even being in concrete, you got different relationships between stiffness and strength. Therefore, the eccentricity stops being a parameter. So the issue is which way we should go, so that we take into account. We all talk about the strength distribution, but what is the real advancement in a unique definition of a strength definition of a center, and how it could be introduced in simple design methods so that we take into account these issues?
Yes, so... In fact, I was mentioning before that we have elastic behavior and we have inelastic behavior. When you have inelastic behavior, the parameters that influence elastic behavior play a lesser role, I would say. So you have the new parameters coming to the picture, which are the force reduction factor, which is basically is a general parameter. Then you have the strength eccentricity and the strength radius, because we made also so the point is that these parameters are easy to compute for a single story structure, whereas in for a multi-story structure it depends. First of all, you have frame, you have shear wall, but even if you have a frame, you have to define a lateral strength at each floor. How you define a lateral strength at each floor? You have to make an assumption of the mechanism that forms. It's easy, for example, if you make an assumption that you have a shear floor mechanism, so you have the sum of the ultimate moments divided by the, and then that gives you a shear strength, shear floor strength. But if this is not the mechanism, it becomes so. In the inelastic range of behavior, I would say in general, things becomes much more complex. One way is to try to define these parameters. What we are trying to do is to see if with few parameters we can capture the main issues. Okay, that's the problem. With few parameters, but of course, if I want to make an exact assessment, I would need to a lot of parameters. Because really, for example, if you want to define strength eccentricity, you have to define for each resisting element a mechanism that develops. And so at least you should first make a kind of numerical analysis of each resisting element. You see which is the mechanism that develops, and also the mechanism that develops depend on the force distribution that you assume that might be different from the one that in the elastic range of behavior. You really need stiffness eccentricity and stiffness radius. This is not the case in the elastic range of behavior. So things become more complex. The idea is to see if, as a function of few parameters, we can capture the main effects.
Alguna otra pregunta? Please, un comentario, Luis? Professor Rodiscova.
My main problem is that I agree with you. The problem is very common with the many parameters.
We also have to have some calibration, that is having some results about how the responses obtained by nonlinear methods, including the plastic things and all that, change the response. And then you have to have some, uncertainty measures that you have to take into account in the design specifications. But I think that is what you have. Now, of course, there's also the possibility of making a step-by-step analysis.
Yes.
For example, yeah. But that is, I think now that is beyond the possibilities of usual practice.
Yeah, that's the point. Because, a question that is made in this sense is that why don't you make inelastic dynamic analysis? Okay, but I'm here in this research center and I make dynamic inelastic analysis, but in design offices is another story.
Yeah.
So that's why pushover analysis is attractive in this.
But further than this is that if you want to do nonlinear step-by-step analysis, you need a design.
Yes.
So what you're going to guess a design and then try it, then that's one comment. But the other one is these versions of extended N2 methods or whatever, return N2 uses or whatever. Yeah. Well, the thing that do not represent the behavior of structures. It represents the behavior of a structure under a condition.
Yes.
That push not the real earthquake forces, because they are a consequence of displacements and damage.
Yeah.
So when there is damage, that's the distribution of forces has nothing to do with what they're using to push the structure.
Yes, so the idea is that you make a comparison. You make a comparison at the end, because we make a in research, we make a comparison. We see which is the damage state that you get with pushover analysis modified. Like the damage state that you get from nonlinear dynamic analysis. If you overestimate damage with your pushover analysis, you are okay. That's the point. That's the idea. The idea is to overestimate because you are on the safe side. But I agree with you. In principle, is quite different. Let's say pushover analysis is a static analysis, and the dynamic analysis. So that's why then you modify it a little bit to account for some dynamic effects, such as the influence of higher modes. The idea is that to see in which conditions you approximate on the safe side with pushover analysis, this is also a nonlinear dynamic analysis.
All right. ¿Alguna otra pregunta, profesor?
In your presentation, you were concerned mainly on the superstructure of the buildings. In one case, we found that the foundation type was important as far as the effect of irregularity. Is there any criteria that you may mention about how to design the foundation in order to restrict the possibility of rather strong irregular effects?
Yes, so of course, I would say let's focus, for example, on torsional behavior. Torsional behavior can be given by structural irregularity of the superstructure, or if the superstructure is very regular, can be given by rotational motion that is transferred from the ground motion to the upper structure, because the assumption that we have uniform ground motion along the foundation of the structure is an assumption. That's why, for example, codes, they do not allow classify building as irregular if it's too much elongated, because in this case we have asynchronous. You have asynchronous acceleration at the end of the building. So you cannot think that your building is the acceleration is uniform along your foundation. Given that the main point, I believe that as you said, I'm more focused on the superstructure. So, but the main point for a foundation is to be rigid at the base of the building, because in this way you simplify the input that the foundation transfers to the superstructure. So stiffness is very important for a foundation in order to reduce the effects of irregularity. Of course, there is this problem of the disuniformity of acceleration along the building foundation, which is a problem, because let's go back to Neumark and Rosenbluth. If you take Neumark and Rosenbluth, this topic is also addressed of the kinematic interaction. It's called kinematic interaction, and they were proposing to fit, let's say, the distribution of the acceleration at the base of the building with the least square line, let's say. So in this way you got a translational, and also the slope of this line gave you a rotational ground motion. Okay, so this is a way, but of course it's a very simplified way to address the problem.
Well, thank you very much, and pleasure to have you.
Thanks very much. Gracias a todos. Gracias.